Why is SpaceX doing the Starship program? Will they even be allowed to continue? When will we see the orbital flight? And where is SpaceX making its heat tiles? And do they evolve over time? And last but not least, what's to know about the upcoming Crew 3 launch and when will it happen? Let's find out.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch. Let's light this candle.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix and I am your host for today's episode of What About It? And as always, there's been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. Starship updates. SpaceX is in the hot phase of preparation before the upcoming orbital Starship launch. You could say they've been in a continuous hot phase for Starship development since they welded the two first ring segments together, but we have to separate the timeline somehow, right? There are plenty of people out there interested in what SpaceX does at Starbase, Texas. And rightfully so. Some are opposed, saying that it will never happen, saying that the idea of building the largest rocket in the world and making it fully reusable at the same time, wanting to land humans on Mars and not to plant a flag, but instead to build a permanent settlement, is just not accomplishable with today's tech. Others are incredibly excited by the idea of one day calling humanity a multiplanetary species. Whatever side you're on, you have to recognize Musk and his team's effort into the idea. Into trying, into doing things differently and trying to change the way we use rockets. He once said that he wants to make rockets 100 times, maybe even 1,000 times better, and that in 30 years from now, people will travel between Earth, Moon, and Mars on SpaceX rockets. The goal is enormous, and the amount of new ideas and work needed are even more immense. Still, they're working on it. Still, they're trying, and even if you don't think that this will actually work, you have to accept the fact that they are actually making a difference already. Driven by Musk and his inventions done with the Falcon 9 rocket family, the whole space industry is in a race to reusable rockets already. Starship is heating up the race even more. So even if you don't believe that all this will work out in the end, it's already silently changing and shaping our future in space. And that's something only a new idea can bring. Real change. There's a saying I want to start today's episode with. People who say it cannot be done should not interrupt those who are doing it. I know, this is a longer intro than usual. Blame it on SpaceX, blame it on Tony Bela and the rest of the crazy bunch of spaceflight enthusiasts, which I am a part of, following SpaceX's development at Starbase. The last time we had so much change in spaceflight was in the Apollo days. No one had ever done it, and plenty believed it couldn't be done. Thank you, Tony, for reminding us all. That being said, let's switch to the YCAM and look at what has been done in recent days to achieve that goal of making the leap into the solar system. Booster 5, currently at the high bay, is making good progress. The SpaceX Starbase workforce is relentlessly working on countless constructions. Super Heavy Booster 5, even though 4 has not flown yet, is continuing the iterative design process. Changed header tank configuration and changed raceway installation routine, just to name a few improvements over hardware that already exists. It usually takes a rocket manufacturer the better part of a year to do what SpaceX seems to be doing in weeks. Booster 5 consists of 3 pieces right now. Mary from NASA Spaceflight was able to take another stunning picture of the booster production pipeline. What you're looking at is a booster thrust pack. It's the slab of solid metal that the inner 13 engines are mounted on. It's a crucial part of the so-called thrust structure. To lift off, the engines need to be able to transfer the generated thrust upwards into the rocket. The thrust pack does almost half of the job. What's unique about this one is that it's for booster 9, meaning that internally SpaceX is already working on a total of 6 boosters by now. At the launch site, SpaceX is working on Super Heavy Booster 4, which is supposed to lift Starship 20 into orbit. And there seems to be more activity on the prototype than in recent weeks. All sorts of subsystems are being installed, and the complexity of a fully built Super Heavy prototype is becoming more and more apparent. It's currently unknown how many Raptors are installed on Booster 4's engine section, but there can't be many missing, and the increased work activity can only mean one thing. We're getting closer to the Super Heavy static fire. If only we knew what these guys know. One interesting fact about the current state of Booster 4 is that it's being kept under constant pressure, even while on the temporary stand. You can see the hoses attached to the fueling adapter. It means that the internal tanks are kept under pressure, which adds hull integrity. Try to crush an empty Coke can compared to a filled one for easy comparison. You'll see instantly what a big difference it makes. The same goes for these prototypes. Musk has recently updated us with an insight into the internal timeline of things to come. If all goes well, Starship will be ready for its first orbital launch attempt next month, pending regulatory approval. So if all goes well, we're at max 1 month away from the first ever orbital launch of a Starship. If all goes well means this. The dreaded FAA environmental assessment is underway by the FAA right now. According to this document, SpaceX doesn't even have a building permit for the integration tower yet. And if it doesn't go well, if the worst case scenario happens, SpaceX would have to take Mechazilla down again. In the worst case, SpaceX's Starship program would be sent to limbo for months, maybe even years. It would basically mean that SpaceX can't continue their work at Starbase. They'd have to propose changes to the infrastructure layout. Perhaps they couldn't launch out of Boca Chica at all. It would set the project back dramatically, and not because it didn't go as planned, but because they wouldn't be allowed to do it at Starbase. It would basically be a catastrophe for the whole project. The FAA has asked the public to voice their opinion. We still have until the end of the week to let them know what we think about the Starship project. Make it count, and I'm explicitly not asking you to go all pro SpaceX. Voice your honest opinion. If it's valid, the FAA should hear it. A link to the forum can be found in the description. Starship 20 has been sitting on suborbital pad B since the recent static fires, and little work has been done on it. It's still missing the heat tiles that fell down during the static fire, and there has been no effort made so far to replace them. It's unknown, as of recording the episode, if SpaceX will do another static fire or if they'll now just repair it for the flight. I'll of course let you know if anything changes. Next, we'll talk Starship heat tile production and SpaceX's upcoming Crew Dragon launch designated Crew 3, so stay tuned, it's worth it. The Y family needs your support. Give the video a like, subscribe, and share it with your friends on Twitter or Facebook to show the YouTube algorithm that you appreciate the content. Looking for a more direct way of support? Become a Patreon or YouTube member by clicking the join button right under the video and get some awesome perks. Gain access to our Discord server, where you can meet me and the rest of the community, or get a completely ad-free release of each and every episode provided just for channel members. Or do you know about the Y Warehouse? Shop for your next Starship shirt, hoodie, or cap, and look as awesome as you feel. We also have a brand new sub-channel called Y Plus. More Y, more Starbase, and more space enthusiasm. The link is in the description, subscribe and ring the bell. Now let's talk Starship heat shields. Starbricks are a crucial part of the Starship success plan. Early fans of the Starship development will know this place. The old Sitco Road site, where SpaceX built the Mark II prototype, which was destined to fly from Kennedy Space Center, but never made it to the pad. It was finally disassembled a week ago, making room for more steaming machines at the site. The device working on site now has sophisticated plumbing and what appears to be turbines of some sort attached to the central column. SpaceX is using the site for chemical production. It's still unknown what exactly SpaceX is doing here, but I guess it's connected to a place close by, the Starbricks Bakery. Starbricks. It's this place, not far from Cocoa Beach. This is where the magic is happening. Inside this building, SpaceX workers are making ceramic heat tiles for the Starship project. And very unique ones too. They need to be highly durable and basically maintenance-free if possible to enable the extreme launch cadence SpaceX is aiming for at Starbase. And ever so often these boxes leave the facility. Huge thanks go out to John Winkup for making these pictures. That's the guy responsible for us having all this info. These boxes are of course shipped to Starbase, Texas, and sadly not to me, where they are used on the latest Starship prototypes. Fast forward on the delivery truck and they land here. This is Starship 20 at the Starbase launch site, and as mentioned before, something is clearly missing here. Some fell off during the static fire, and if you look closely, the shield doesn't look too uniform either. It's the first prototype, and that's what that looks like. But is there any progress? Will SpaceX be able to make that magically good heat shield that's needed for the goal of a fully reusable rocket launching thrice per day? Let's take a look at Starship 21, the next one in line. Remember, SpaceX has an iterative design process. This is a segment of Starship 21's hull. The picture was taken on October 24th by our wonderful Luis Rodriguez at Starbase, and there might be tiles from the crates John photographed on here. And if you look closely, you can already see a difference to Ship 21's heat shield. Let's make a side-by-side comparison. The attachment method does look identical. We have two underlying layers, the white ceramic wool and then a thin black mesh-like sheet on top of that. The characteristic three metal pins welded on the stainless steel hull are present as well. And sometimes they seem to be falling off on Starship 21 as well, as can be seen by the missing tiles, so there is no change here. The surface of the Ship 21 tiles does look more glossy. This could be due to them being brand new and Ship 20 having been at the launch site for a while. The placement of the tiles does look at least a bit more uniform. There are small white dots on the star bricks. Each one is on the up-facing corner. These very likely are not cosmetic in nature. They are for orientational purpose or a guidance marker of some sort. Overall, the two heat shields already do look different. Iterative design. Lewis also did a peek into one of the production tents for us and captured the Starship 21 nose cone being worked on. Besides the heat shield now almost done, the robot responsible for welding the attachment pins into place can be seen again as well. It might even be responsible for putting them in place. One thing is for sure. SpaceX will have to find a different method of attaching the tiles to the hull. The current one seems to be much too weak for the purpose. It doesn't matter if the tiles can withstand the heat and are low maintenance if they keep falling off. What do you think? Do you have any idea of how to improve the attachment method? As always, tell me in the comments. Crew 3 launch preparation. On the other side of the US, SpaceX is currently working hard to get the next Crew Dragon ready for its mission towards the ISS, and I have the latest news for you before the launch. Do you like launches? Do you like Crew Dragon and Falcon 9 in an epic combination? Are you from the US? Get an alarm clock, because this one will be in the middle of the night. SpaceX is getting ready for its next launch to the ISS. Internally called Dragon C210, Crew Dragon Endurance will do its maiden flight towards the International Space Station on October 31st. After extensive training, including some EVA exercises at the famous Astronaut Training Center in Houston, Texas, the crew of four is ready for their journey with Team SpaceX. Launching from historic Pad 39A at Kennedy Space Center in the early morning hours of October 31st, Crew 3 continues the six-flight contract for the new Crew Dragon vehicle. From left to right, we have Kayla Barron, the flight engineer, Raja Chari, the commander, Matthias Maurer, a payload specialist, and Thomas Marshburn, pilot of the spacecraft. Three times NASA and Maurer, of course from Germany and from ESA. They are part of Expedition 66 and 67, which begins in April of next year. And their planned stay is until late April. Originally, the fourth seat, now taken by Kayla Barron just getting into a training EVA suit here, was supposed to go to the first Russian astronaut aboard a Crew Dragon, which was meant to start a barter agreement which would see NASA and Roscosmos trade seats on the Soyuz and commercial crew vehicles. This agreement is now going to begin after Crew 3. As said, the rocket will launch at 2:21 a.m. local time at Kennedy Space Center, so set your alarm clock and get the coffee ready. It'll definitely be worth it. Let's save the world, right? But first, let's order something on Amazon, fly to a vacation and turn up the AC, because it's hot today, right? Listen, I have the same problem. We all do. We're all living in the same world and that show must go on. But it might not if we don't change our habits. The facts are there in plain sight. Can we have both? Is there any easy enough way to balance the two problems out? We can all concur that Elon Musk might be a smart man, right? Musk wants to build starships to make us multiplanetary. If all the rumors about climate change and the environment going to hell is wrong, then why does this smart man believe that the window of opportunity for such an endeavor might be limited in time? There are ways out of this dilemma, and today's sponsor, Ren, is one of them. REN is a very simple website where you can do the magic trick. You can calculate your carbon footprint and then they give you a price tag to offset that carbon footprint as much as possible by funding projects that plant trees and protect the rainforest. It's an easy way to put your money where your mouth is and actually start doing something about the climate crisis. By answering a few questions about your lifestyle, you can find out your carbon footprint and how you can reduce it. No one can reduce their carbon footprint to zero, so you can offset what you have left after reducing. REN posts every receipt they get for their support of all the projects. You can research all the projects yourself. Everything is transparent. You also receive monthly updates from the tree planting, rainforest protection, and other projects you support. No one can end the climate crisis on their own, but together we can make a difference. If you feel that strange urge to do something as well, you can start helping today by learning more on REN.co. I've partnered with REN to plant 10 extra trees for the first 100 people who sign up using my referral link. And yes, I'm signed up too. Today's supporter shoutout goes to Flacco da Birdie and many others. You rock so much. Your support enables us to expand the Y content further, implement new features, or open up sub-channels like Y+. You are a cornerstone of the Y family, and for that, we all salute you. Make sure to hop on our supporter-exclusive Discord to join more than 1,000 spaceflight enthusiasts and to give me a chance to thank you in person. At the end of today's episode, I want to take a moment to give Tony Bela and some very talented 3D artists a massive shout out. They've made an unofficial Starship calendar together and it turned out to be absolutely fantastic. If you want one, a link to order it can be found in the description. I got mine, I'm not sponsored, it's a fantastic piece of art and absolutely worth it. Guys, you rock. Alright. Gotta make yourself laugh. It's currently unknown how many Raptors are installed on Booster 4's engine section. I'm sorry. Alright, contenance. I'm sorry. Alright. Okay, let's do that. All right, stop. Okay, here we go. come on. I'm silly. I'm sorry, B. That's what happens. All right, we can do this. Whew.